going to do, because the Habilis tools are so unique, we're going to get Stephen to actually go through and explain the thought process behind each of the tools and how they're used. Over to you, Stephen.
Yeah, if you don't mind, I'll start with the hand axe since we're here at it. And my idea behind it was to make a small tomahawk style head that you could haft in the field so you don't have to carry all the additional weight, but still make it where you could use it as an ulu and add some other functionality, like once the sheath is on it, you have a boring tool so you can structure fireboard. We've also given a lot of lashing points so that it can be hooked up as a almost like an ad storm so that you could use it as a scraper to work hides. I did leave the tips unsharpened so that you don't have to worry about cutting through a hide when you're fleshing it. And then it has some measurement devices on it, like an inclinometer and an angle gauge, just to help you if you're trying to figure out the direction that a tree is going to fall. Okay. If you're on a slope and it's hard to judge which way it's leaning, you just basically use it as a plumb bob. And then I also put a solar compass cheat sheet basically on the back. If you mark your two shadow points 15 minutes apart and put the tips on accordingly, you'll be aiming north. And that was the idea. I just wanted something very useful but very light, and it weighs in under 4 ounces.
There you go. And then the next one, which is a variation.
There again, just to move more into the woodworking aspect of what that tool was intended to do, I came up with the adze, and it's based on a traditional flat adze. The adze is probably the oldest woodworking tool after the axe. There again, I didn't want to just do a traditional adze, so I did make it where it's filled haftable. I just put it on an L-shaped stick in order to use it for carving out larger pieces. And then on the back side, I put a spoon scraper just to help you, after you've used your knife and you're getting down to the polishing process, this allows you to remove just that finest amount of material so that you can finish it out with a nice smooth spoon that's going to be easier to clean and use.
And I like the way that you've actually got things you've made with them to show people exactly what can be achieved with the tools.
Right, absolutely. And I spent about three and a half hours on this one after I burned it down.
Yep.
And I didn't want to go too deep though, just to kind of show it in the process.
Exactly, yeah.
Next would be the bow tool. I actually got into all of this through primitive archery, or that's what brought me back into it, I should say. Just love bows and arrows, wanted to make my own, and there's not a lot of tools out there other than big shock tools that are aimed at that, and I really enjoy taking a stave along on a camping trip and working on it as I want to instead of sitting in a shop in a climate-controlled environment, so that I could have something really light to throw in my pack. I basically made a draw scraper. I didn't want to make a true draw knife because I didn't want to be peeling off too much material. And then as I looked at it, I thought, well, I could put a river cane arrow shaft straightener in it, a hardwood arrow straightener, and then the scrapers that would work along with those. Mm-hmm. And since twisting a string is one of the things that I least enjoy about making a bow, I added these two holes so that you can put a handle through here with a knot on one side, run your string material through here, and twist it like a party noisemaker, and it will twist up your string.
Oh, really? And that's what done this?
Yes, sir.
Oh, excellent. Okay.
And just move it right along. Up front here, this is not actually a product that we make, but at Habilis, I'm always striving to find products that I think would be of value to people that are not necessarily made by me, but may have got lost in the shuffle of the modern age. A lot of the things where people just have overlooked them. And a squirrel cooker is a great cooking device. It's easy to carry.
I saw that being used at the show.
And the nice thing about it is it does have the fork on one end, so you can do animals, meats, even roasting vegetables.
Yeah.
But on the opposite end, it does have a hook, which is perfect to hang your billy claw or some bucket from.
Yeah.
So you get multifunctionality out of a single piece. And one of the guys even told me that he uses his to hold his fishing rod when he's not cooking, and so he gets a new, even another use out of it. After that, I'll move on to the spear point type knives. trigger points have gained popularity a lot over the last few years, but I hated to do something that's so single purpose. So what I wanted to do was basically make a hog hunting top spear point, but let it double as your utility knife for very fine carving, or if you've got a skin squirrel, you don't really need a 6-inch blade to do a squirrel shoot. I tend to go to that knife a lot also in my daily use, just cutting up paper, opening a box. I've almost always got one of those on me for the day-to-day. Because it is such a short blade, it fits every legality and all the states that are.
Okay.
This is actually the knife that started Habilis Bush Tools. I was always a knife fanatic, and I really just couldn't find the knife that I felt did everything that I expected out of a woodcraft, bushcraft style knife.
Yeah.
So I spent several years actually designing, making basic prototypes, testing them, seeing what felt right, until this actually evolved out of that process. It's a 3/16 inch thick piece of 1095 steel that we start with. It has a continuously curved cutting edge, so it's really good for working with wood and meat. We do what we call a pseudo scandy grind. We start with a traditional scandy, but then we add a secondary bevel just to make it easier for field sharpening. One of the unique features of it is we put what we call the anvil in it, and if you're batoning to split wood, it acts as a catch point and almost acts like a splitting throw to put that force right where you need it. Moving back into the handle, we've got a couple of lash points, so you could extend the handle to get more momentum or even use it as a spear. I would typically never do that myself, but I have lashed it up to use to break dry wood out of up in a tree, and also I've mounted it on an L-shaped stick and used it as a scythe to harvest grass using like a bed or
I mean, I could see me using something like the lashing point for harvesting bracket fungus dry up in a tree.
Oh yeah.
Something that's soft, you know, something easy to cut out.
Absolutely.
And the beauty of this anvil point as well, I've always been really reluctant to hit the tip of my knife, because it's the thinnest part of the blade, isn't it?
Yes,
and you start hitting the thinnest part, but this actually gives you the full focus point, which keeps it on the thickest part,
Sir. And the other thing that I like is it works well as a handle. So if you're doing a fine shaving, I think you even did that in one of your videos where you were shaving a stick. And that was really cool for me to see, because that part of it never occurred to me. It's like the more I use it, the more uses I found for it. But the last two key features, in my opinion, would be we do put a fire bearing in each one. So if you're going to do a bow drill set, the hardest part to find in the wilderness to me is a good low friction bearing.
Definitely, definitely.
And then, so you've always got one of those with you. And then the extended tang, so that if you need to crack a nut or break bark up, but that's the tool that really started it all, and all of these other pieces pretty much evolved as companion pieces to it. Our next knife actually is the Trapper, and basically what happened was I wanted to take some of the key elements of the Bush tool and put them in a more traditional package. There's a lot of guys out there who like a very traditional Scandinavian or French trapper design. So basically what I wanted to do is take that old design but modernize it slightly by keeping the lines, adding a finger tool to make it a little easier to check out the fine work. And there again, we maintain those two lashing points and the fire bearing, similar to what the Bush tool would be.
I like the way you keep the black finish as well, especially with 1095, which in some of these humid environments can rust really quick.
Absolutely, and the reason that we use this one, it's a phosphorus-based gun gluing, so it starts the patina process. You're still going to get that nice natural finish as it gets used, but you don't have to worry about maintaining it until that occurs. Especially here in Georgia, where our average humidity is around 70%, knives will flash rust sitting on a table. So there again, and we've started doing a leather sheet and a cotton
plastics in them.
This is actually our newest knife. We released it at the Pathfinder Gathering last week. But we're calling it the Self-Reliance Tool. Mm-hmm. It's a variant, a variation of the Bush Tool.
Yep.
Several of my friends are school. They believe in the school of heavy choppers. They really like a large knife. They feel that they can do more with it. So as to not alienate them, I made a knife that would fit that criteria. We still have the continuous curve cutting edge like the Bush Tool. And from this point forward, it's about a quarter inch wider than the Bush Tool, but in all other ways, the same. And we did add the finger tool, which lengthened us out about an inch and a half.
Yep.
So a lot more chopping force there. I did add a secondary lanyard point, mm-hmm. so that you can do a twist up top lanyard, so that you can actually drop it away and easily react.
Oh, okay.
There again, the two standard lash points, as we've always had on the Habilis tools, the fire bearing, and then this is one of our newer features. I call it the dog bone end. So it kind of has that feel of the shape of the dog bone.
Yeah.
It has a traditional quarter inch hole, but also we have an A3/8 hole. So that if you're working with aerial material, like blackberry brambles, you can deform it more fast. You just rip it through.
Yeah, that would be useful.
Always a pleasure.
Excellent. Okay, this is Sean the Silver Fox with the Habilis crew at the Blade Show.